Okay. So we just finished up the introduction, and hopefully you weren't too stressed about that. Like I said, it's more of a thing of you just giving me information so I can meet you where you're at, and I can take you on this journey of where you want to go with art or design. That's kind of the whole point of the introduction. I just wanted to be able to get a little bit more information about you to kind of unpack things. And help you on your journey of art or design, more so than like put you under the gun right out the blocks, right? So now I want to introduce you to your first project that we're actually going to do here in class. And hope I don't have the right one. Let me get down here. So, basically, what I want to do is I want to introduce the concept of having you look at failure in a different way. I know, so there's a big issue that currently happens in society with your generation right now. I think a lot of it has to do with social media in general. We have a tendency to somebody messes something up and they just get put on blast, and it's annoying because like we have all these websites like Fail Army and just all these videos where you just get made fun of, you get turned into a meme, like it's a horrible thing, right? And it causes a lot of apathy, it causes a lot of animosity to where you just don't want to do things because you don't want to fail, right? So I propose to you this. I want you to start to rethink failure and look at it in a different sense. I want you to put a positive spin on it, so to speak. This whole concept came up because I've said this before in class, but teachers, we have to go to school too. So the fortunate thing is, as a group, the faculty was afforded the opportunity to actually go down to Vallejo, California, and we actually went to a thing called PBL Works, and we did our PBL World, PBL Works, where we started learning about PBL, which stands for project-based learning, and I likened to this so much because, I mean, as a designer, as an artist, I mean, everything I do is pretty much a project. So it kind of understanding how to work through a project and how to present that as an instructional base of material is a great thing because that's, like I said, that's what we do as designers, that's what we do as artists. We have to go through this kind of project loop in general to get you from ideation all the way to fruition. That's like a big thing. So I am presenting, so I'm getting very meta with this because I am presenting a lesson for you, well, not just a lesson, but a project for you where we're doing a design or artistic rebrand of failure, and the project itself, I'm going to talk a little bit about the PBL process and how that works, and then kind of loop back and explain what it all kind of like means. But it's just to kind of give you ideas of the direction I want you to go to kind of really work with this and kind of think through it and everything. So starting off, like just this whole kind of concept of looking at failure in a different way. Now, maybe it's just a poster. Maybe you just want to make a poster and say, hey, let's look at failure differently, and we can actually just create a poster. So something like this. Maybe this is just your idea, right? We make a poster, it's like, quit the nagging, and then we have this F paper and everything, and it just is like, rebrand the F. We don't want it to be F anymore, so even though F is for failure, F is for feedback, like we could say F is for feedback, and then F is for whatever you want it to be. So like in the sense of rebranding failure, we talk about something that's positive about feedback, like changing the F to feedback, because that's an important thing, right? Or just whatever you want it to be. So that's what I'm proposing to you. How are you going to rebrand it in such a way that it will be something that is positive to you? Like the sense of failure, or the letter F itself, like, how can we change it so it is something positive for you? Okay, and it doesn't have to be a poster, like I was just showing you this as an example, but this is kind of like a concept for it. So like I said, we went to this PBL Works thing, where we started learning about project-based learning, and in day one, we start talking about like the process of going through a project and everything. How we actually start out, and what the whole intent of everything is as we go through the whole process of project-based learning itself. So we start out, like, you get the idea or the concept, and you basically launch your project, right? Here, the launch for us in class is rebranding failure, or rebranding the letter F, right? And I'm presenting to you this as an idea. So then we go to the next step, to where you yourself, you need to start doing research, or just kind of digging in and kind of thinking about how you can actually change the concept of failure, or change the concept of that letter grade F that you see, and how you can change it in such a way that it starts to become a more positive thing, something that feels better for you. So you start to do the research, and then you go through and you start to develop it, right? And once you develop it, then you allow me to give you a critique on it, and that is what's called feedback, constructive criticism or feedback. So once I give you that feedback, you go back and you start to do a little bit more research, or just kind of rebuild, right? And give me a new iteration of it using the feedback. And then you resubmit, and then we talk about it, and we can keep on doing this for a while. And this going back and forth right here is what's called the feedback loop, right? So going back and forth, you can actually use feedback to actually create a better product. So going through iterations is completely fine. So just going back through this loop and stuff like that is a way to look at, hey, failure is an option. It's just using positive feedback is the best thing, the best way to go about it. Like, you need to fail so you can get feedback and you can correct it and go through. Because the more iterations of this feedback loop that you get to, by the time you actually go to your full-on presentation and giving your final presentation with defense, you've gone through enough iterations that you feel comfortable enough about this final deliverable that you're giving. And that's a really big important concept to understand about this, okay? So the funny thing is, like, so this is the way that they present like the initial project-based learning cycle, right, from the get-go and everything. But this was actually like a 3-day event. So if you look up in the wall in the room, you'll actually see that there's this nice little graphic over there that's sitting right beside the door as you walk out the room. But they present that to us with all these gold standards that are actually added into the PBL. And when I started reading through it, I realized that it literally was still just those four steps. It's just a lot of those extra gold standard steps were actually built into that feedback loop. It's all really mainly about that feedback loop. And that's why I'm really trying to hit home with this idea of feedback, because like I said, failure is an option as long as you're using good feedback. So me saying that, like, that is conceptually like my rebrand of failure itself. To basically say, like, this idea of feedback is what you should start looking at failure as. Like, yes, we need to fail so we can get feedback, because that is the important big concept of it, right? so we can go through this feedback loop, so we can go through as many iterations as possible to actually get to a point where we actually want to give our presentation, because we feel comfortable with what we're actually presenting, that we can actually defend it and say, this is what I really want to be putting forth in the world, right? And the reason I say it like that is, as an artist or as a designer, and this is my opinion, but I mean, I just think it really makes sense, just kind of looking at the landscape of things that actually happens politically and just everything that happens today in this world, right? As a designer and as an artist, we should be very intentional about the things we do. Like, and when I say that, being intentional, you should really understand that as a designer or as an artist, you have a specific voice. And as you mature into that, like you need to know that you have power with that voice, and you need to understand how you can actually utilize it. I think it is our responsibility as designers and artists to actually use that voice in a positive way, right? And that's why even just talking about failure and rebranding it to be a positive thing, that's I think that intentionality of talking to people and giving a positive spin on everything is important. It really is important. I mean, we should learn how to have open discussions and be able to come to compromise, or at least agree to disagree, and not have it come to such a conflict that we're hurting each other and damaging things. Like we should learn how to fix things, vice destroy things and break things. So enough of that little soapbox there and everything, but like I said, like, it is my opinion that we really need to be very intentional about the things we do. And with that being said, right, so in art and design, you will be given various techniques and various things to kind of look at and everything, that you can start taking these techniques and kind of molding it the way that you want to, so you can actually be intentional about the things that you do. And that's a big importance, right? Like, you really want to be able to use the techniques that are actually presented to you, so you can be intentional, right? And that's my goal in this class, really. Like, as we work through things, and as I meet you where you're at, to actually start trying to help you get to where you want to go, the goal is that I'm giving you these techniques and these tools that you can actually utilize for yourself to get to where you want to go, right? That's a big important thing for me, is to kind of have this conversation so I can get you to where you want to go, right? So I actually have a few videos in here that I put in here for you and everything, to just kind of like talk about a few things. So let me pull up this. Oh, actually, I already have it pulled up. So here's a video on Adobe After Effects where this gentleman is talking about face tracking, right?
Then at the bottom here, there's mask one. You're going to right-click that, and you're going to click track mask, and that'll bring your tracker window up here.
He's doing this face tracking and everything. It's like a nine minute and 41 second video. It's a decent video, and it goes through and explains face tracking, right? And yeah, if you're into Adobe After Effects and you like all this technical stuff and everything, cool, right? And you're like, man, that's nice if I'm into Adobe, but Tom, like, why are you telling me this stuff? Because, like, I don't use Adobe After Effects, and I don't really know what. And I was like, so, do you like dance videos? I know a lot of people TikTok nowadays and everything, so understanding this concept of what's going on with face tracking and everything can kind of help you look for different programs that do this and everything. And one thing that the TikTok app does, you can actually create like face tracking effects to actually make your videos pop. And let me show you this.
I got to draw this one. Oh, get it!
if you see this jerkiness, this kind of like effect of what's actually happening in the video itself, that's because they're using not necessarily face tracking, but they're using focal points in the video itself that actually cause it to have that hurt. So it actually has more of an intentional effect to where you're able to kind of get it to grab your attention. So maybe even if that's not your type of music, like you don't like a ski mask, a foot fungus, if you don't like that stuff, I mean, still the video itself has a different quality to it, to where it causes you to notice it because you're using a technique that is built in artistic design, right? Using that focal point to track it and everything and pull the video around is kind of a tool that they're using to make it intentional. So like if you use that effect in your TikTok videos, it can cause definitely a difference to make people get attracted to that video. So maybe you get more likes, and it should never be about the likes, but I mean sometimes it helps. It gives you a warm fuzzy feeling and everything, so it helps. But along those lines, it's like using something like that to be a lot more intentional about it actually kind of helps along the path of having fun with it. Now something a little bit completely different is in animation itself, they have a thing called motion capture, and this is where you like wear like a green suit and it's got little white balls on it and everything. And the reason they do this is because they can literally make a fake character and they can film a video using motion capture, and then those white balls are set up so they can attach a rigging to it so that character can actually dance and move with whatever's being animated by the actor that's in the suit itself. And the reason I'm telling you about this is because with that intentionality, right, there is a video game called League of Legends. It's done by Riot Games, and every year they have the Worlds, because it's a game that where teams completely compete and everything. So they have a Worlds event to where they took four of their characters for League of Legends, and then they reskinned them to turn them into an actual K-pop group, to where and some of you know this, some of you know you've heard about KDA. It's actually a K-pop group of four of the characters in League of Legends. Obviously they're not real people, but they have real people doing the voices. Two American pop stars, Madison Beer and Jay Reburns, and then two of the singers from a K-pop group called G-Idle. Those are the four that comprise the group itself. So at Worlds they were performing, right, and they're up on stage singing, up there dancing, singing and everything. So I tell you about this mocap thing because you see them all there and everything, but they literally use motion capture, and you actually have the characters actually there on the stage with them. Like you can actually see them because they're being projected by cameras and stuff like that. So using that intentionality, you can literally make imaginary characters and make them explode with magic and stuff like that. But even more than that, you can have them come out of the sky and float down during a concert and everything, which is just crazy. Like, this is insane what technology can actually do with us when we're intentional about it, and we can actually do some really cool stuff. But now you can see that things like that have power. So you really do have to be pretty smart about how you're using this stuff, because you don't want it to be so distracting that it's taking away from a good purpose, right? And that's a big importance of it. So So with that kind of concept, this is, I just wanted to launch with you this whole concept of trying to put the idea of your head that we need to rebrand failure in such a way that it has a more positive spin, right? So start thinking about your rebrand of failure, how you actually want to do it, right? And if you don't want to start working right on the rebrand of failure, effectively what I wanted you to do is we're going to I'm going to spark your creativity by giving you the SAM prompt where if we think about the seven deadly sins, gluttony, lust, pride, greed, sloth, wrath, and envy, right? I want you to think about those seven deadly sins and figure out which one resonates with you or which one is kind of like something that is your antithesis, right? Something that is like is completely opposite of you, right? Just kind of looking through those seven deadly sins. And you, like always, using your SAM, you can either sketch it, you can write a poem, you can pull out song lyrics from a song, like just something to help kind of spark your creativity. But more so, like once you kind of get into the flow and everything, don't get too inundated in the SAM prompt itself. I really want you to start that rebrand of failure, so we can do that feedback loop, right? We can go through that process of getting through that feedback, because the more iterations you do, right, the more iterations that you go through that and everything, you're going to feel a lot more comfortable with that final product that you're presenting to me, right? So I definitely want you to kind of think about it, start digging into it, and start doing your rebrand. But if you need to spark your creativity in different ways and everything, please, more power to you. Utilize the SAM the way I want you to, like really dig into things and just kind of think about things. But try to start on that process of digging into your rebrand of failure or rebranding the F. Okay, so as always, just kind of think about things, unpack things, and create.